Everyone, welcome back to Between Two Friends. Very excited today to welcome Abe Ng, the owner and proprietor of Sushi Maki. And if you are a South Florida resident, then you have seen Sushi Maki all over the place because it has grown like crazy, been very successful. And I've gotten to know Abe over the past few years, and I'm just very excited to have him today and lots of good questions to ask. So Abe, thank you so much for joining us today. I believe you grew up in Miami, right?
Yeah, I was born and raised in Miami, Baptist Hospital, and grew up in Kendall. Went to Palmetto Elementary, Middle, and High School, so I'm a local.
So we got a new Supreme Court justice, of course. Jeff Bezos, everybody knows, went to Palmetto, right. and now you. It's been a good run for Palmetto High.
Yeah, it's a great place.
When did you get into the food business, and how did that come along?
So my parents, immigrants to this country, you know, we're in the food business. We had Chinese restaurants, Chinese takeout first, and then a full service restaurant, Canton. So I've been in and around the food all my life. I remember kind of growing up when my mom was, at the cashier, dad was cooking at a wok, and I was taking a nap on rice bags in the kitchen. So my fondest and earliest memories were that in the restaurant.
You know, did that make you want to get in the food business, or was there a time you were like, no, thanks, this is not?
Yeah, no, I think the sacrifice, the hours, and, you know, what made me want to run far away. But, you know, there's so many things about the business that were magical. You know, I love food. I love team building. I love the creative aspect of it. You know, it took some time, and there was never any pressure from mom and dad for me to get into the family business. And I kind of took a roundabout way of getting involved. But I think that's the best way for somebody to look at getting into a family business. Do you really want it? You know, particularly one that's as grueling as a restaurant business.
Was there a thought, did you ever think maybe I want to go into business, but not the food business, right? Like, maybe there's something else for me.
For sure. So I studied kind of hospitality finance in college, and liked the asset management side of it, you know, even the hotel side of it. But the actual food and the restaurant part of the business, you know, just requires a lot of dedication. But what I will tell you is that there is no more rewarding business where you can come up with an idea, you can implement it, you know, see satisfaction, see results, see impact, you know, job create. There's nothing like the restaurant business. It is a wonderful business when done right. Now, you know, there's for sure challenges, you know, now more so than ever. And we as an industry need to be better employers, treat people better, you know, help them kind of sort their lives better, for sure. But at the end of the day, it's a fun industry. It really is.
I was a busboy right after I graduated high school before college. You know, I needed a summer job, wanted to make some money. So this was at the Albuquerque airport where I grew up.
Okay. I did not know this. Tell me more. Yeah. Tell me everything.
Yeah. Not anything too crazy, but I agree with you. When we were busy, you know, you would blink and 2 hours had passed.
I've talked to people in all other sectors, like, you know, maybe it's medical or construction. Everybody says that, like, some of the best employees are ones that have worked in the restaurant business, because it teaches a lot about responsibility, about humanity. You know, it doesn't matter, you know, how smart or what you have. You know, we all know, my dad always said that the most important person is the dishwasher. Because if they don't show up that day, you know, everything, you know, goes downhill. So, you know, you learn a lot about kind of people. And I think that it's an invaluable lesson. Everybody should spend. It's why you look at so many successful executives, you know, when you see their bios, first job may have been, you know, at a McDonald's or you know, working at a country club. So I think all these lessons in life are often taught well in the restaurant business.
Yeah, I mean, it's the best place if you want to learn how to interact with people and have reasonable interactions, just how to converse with people and get in and out of conversations is a really important life skill. And I think it's a segue into sales. And I've always said, if you can sell, you will always be employable.
Right. Well, and that's the other thing. Everybody should work on commission basis, right? You gotta eat what you kill. And those are the two jobs. Funny you said that. Somebody said commission sales and working in a restaurant.
Yep. Yeah, exactly. So why sushi? And when did you finally settle on opening a sushi restaurant?
So my first restaurant venture was a failed one. We had a Mexican kind of wrap restaurant called Rapido that was globally inspired cuisine and tortillas. Opened it up in 1997, and that didn't work out. And a few years after, we looked entrepreneurially, what did Miami need? And hard to believe in 2000, there weren't a lot of sushi bars in Miami. And if there were, there were super high end, super intimidating for first time sushi eaters. So we wanted to come up with a friendly neighborhood sushi bar that was welcoming to first time sushi eaters, as well as having really amazing fresh fish, so that even sushi snobs would also come. And that's how Sushi Maki was born in 2000, looking to democratize and demystify sushi. That was a heroic mission. And it started with one restaurant in South Miami on Sunset Drive. And we converted our second Rapido in Coral Gables to a Sushi Maki. And that's the beginning of the story 22 years ago.
It's, you mentioned your first restaurant was a failure, and you used the word failure, and the way you were able to say that without like taking it personally or being emotional, it was just the first iteration of your business journey. And that's so, right. Some people are going to want to pounce on perceived failures, but for the most part, it's just learning. And I think that's the important lesson.
Right. So I learned more in those 3 years during the failure than I have in the probably the last 22. I think it's, the challenge kind of really teaches you, do you have what it takes to persevere? Because it would have been very easy to get out and get a more conventional job. It teaches you a lot about, the support around you. My family was very supportive. My dad was a partner in the first venture, but became much more involved in the second. And lastly, kind of my wife, newlywed at the time, had a great job. She was a lawyer, and we were able to survive the first 3 years of our marriage, taking, in 2000 to 2003 without me taking a salary. And I think that's a big part of it. Your life partner, your spouse, they have to get it that the sacrifice. And fortunately, she did, and she comes from a family of small business owners. So understanding the dedication that it takes and the sacrifice. I for sure consider my wife to be a co-founder of Sushi Maki, and she's very involved at the legal strategic level, and before that the marketing. So I think those are some things that are super important. That village, that surrounds a founder and entrepreneur is extraordinarily important. And, just kind of being a local guy, I think people have always rooted for our success. And I'm so grateful for everyone that's been with us on this ride.
So I remember eating at Sushi Maki. So I moved to Miami in 2005, and, I had eaten sushi before. But you mentioned sort of demystifying or taking the fright out of it, because for somebody who doesn't really know, to walk into a sushi restaurant, like, you don't really know how to order and what you're ordering. It can be intimidating. It's kind of like, I don't want to say the wrong things and look like a fool.
That was kind of that ethos, that the training that we do, we tell people that, remember the first time you went into a Starbucks and the person in front of you said, I'll have a triple venti, no foam latte. And then when you get to the line, you just said, I'll just have a coffee, because you're so intimidated.
Yeah.
And we wanted people to remember that the feeling of, feeling stupid was what we didn't want people to feel at Sushi Maki. So if you pronounce, it's slightly wrong, or when somebody orders sashimi, just clarifying it, that's the slices of fish without rice, without, you know, being accusatory or talking down to people. That's what the feeling that we wanted our chefs and our servers to convey. So that's what the Sushi Maki way is all about.
Your strategy was, let me go in like a dine-in casual, something that I can expand a little faster. Was that always the plan or did it evolve?
I've always wanted to be part of something that could grow, to have multiple units. I'm a brand guy. I've loved brands. So Sushi Maki, you know, from the beginning, we always try to invest in high quality and taste and in the way we, you know, presented a brand. So yeah, in the back of my head, for sure, I always said, how can we do more? How can we get bigger? But, you know, I've also had a lot of great mentors that said, you know, like, keep focused on making one great restaurant profitable, two great restaurants profitable, and the rest will come. So it's that delicate balance of having kind of great big ambition, you know, and a grand vision, but also, you know, keeping your head down, and because you can lose yourself if you're not focusing on 10 years from now in the day to day. But at the same time, you can be in an ivory tower and kind of talk about like world domination, and you know, the restaurants are falling apart, you know, at the restaurant level. So you got to do both.
When you walk into a restaurant, you kind of feel right away if it's a friendly place or not. And it's the people, how you recruit and grow a team, to me is what's going to be the biggest difference, because you can have all the plans in the world, but if you can't find really great people to make customers feel like you can't be in 26 locations at the same time. So, you know, what's your philosophy on recruiting and maintaining and, you know, great people?
Yeah, you know, that's why it is so hard, because, you know, you're right. You step in and you can feel whether or not there's good energy or not. And you do your best to try to hire, you know, people with that disposition, and you hire for that kind of energy and you train for that skill, but you got to have people that on down the line that kind of share that. And, you know, you got to be in the stores. So I try to make sure that I'm at least a half a dozen stores a week visiting. You can tell when you walk in if people are, you know, want to be there or not. And you desperately want to try to, you know, create that environment where people are feeding it, because, you know, you care for the frontline team members, because they're the ones that are going to interact with the guest. And so many times people try to skip, you know, your employee and go right to the guest, but you can't have that connection, you know, and Richard Branson said it beautifully that, you know, you take care of your employees and they'll take care of the guests, you know? So yeah, you can't skip the front line, and you're nothing without them.
Look, Abe, I know how hard you work, man. I've chatted with you enough, and you and your wife are just workaholics. But at the same time, you know, you maintain a great family life, just a really an asset to the South Florida community. As we kind of land the plane on this interview, because we try to keep them short, what are the next 5 years bringing for Sushi Maki? You know, what's next?
So I think South Florida just has so much opportunity for growth. We could triple the size of the company and just be in the Miami-Dade, Broward County and Palm Beach County areas. But we also have some partnerships that are unique that could take us to different parts of the state. We do a lot of work with non-traditionals like universities, and there we partner with Compass and the Aramarks. So there's opportunities to look at other campuses. We do work at an airport here, and that I think is an interesting model that could possibly grow to other airports. And, you know, finally, our probably most prized partnership is with Whole Foods Market. And, you know, recently our region was consolidated with the Southeast region, the Florida region. So, you know, there's just so much opportunity, but, you know, there's several stores for Whole Foods that are growing here in South Florida that, you know, we have to prepare our succession plan to grow, you know, from 12 to 16 stores at Whole Foods. So I think to answer your question, I think it's both. We want to make sure that we hold serve and take care of South Florida, but, you know, we're kind of an entrepreneur at heart, and always, we're really fired up about the future. I'm 48, I think the best days of Sushi Maki are ahead. And it's just a really exciting season to be here in South Florida, to be in the restaurant business.
You know, just growing to grow is not a good strategy. I don't need to quote unquote go to multi-states or go national.
That's right.
To grow, because distribution gets harder. Everything gets so much tougher. That's, you know, that's right. The side of the business people don't think about. They just see multiple locations and think, oh, you know, this is easy. But the logistics behind it, like you said, we can triple the size here in South Florida. And if you stick to a vertical and don't, you know, try to change and grow in the wrong way, it can save you a lot of heartache.
The restaurant business is littered with companies that have grown in weird ways, you know, slow and steady can win the race. So that's the way we look at it. I think it fits in with, I've got kids, 17, 15, and 13, you know, love kind of being around them and not being on planes. And I think all of these things are part of the decision calculus and how to grow and, you know, at what pace.
Absolutely. Lots that we could talk about, my friend, but we're going to go ahead and end on that note. And again, I really just want to thank you. You guys are so busy and I really appreciate you carving out this time for us.
Oh, today. Yeah. I love this and I love that you're doing this. And you really are a gem in this community, just a terrific lawyer and advisor and someone who, you know, who really gets it. So I appreciate it. So
well, listen, thank you for saying that. And all the best to everybody and your team for me. And we'll talk to you again soon, Abe. Take care.
Sure. Thanks, Brett.
Okay. Bye-bye.